Morning. Welcome, welcome. Welcome, replay people. I don't even know what to call you. Honestly. Earlier I had like 45 people listening to me when I just talked. I didn't do anything. I just talked about my testimony. I'll turn my music down. If anybody wants to listen to this music, it's online streaming, and it is familylife.org. Familylife.org is what I'm listening to. And when you get on the site, you see across the very top, there's like Facebook and all this. And it says something, good morning, good morning. God bless you. God bless you and your loved ones. Hallelujah. And across the top, it'll say, listen. And this is what this is. This is their streaming. And I have it. There's many different styles of music that you can listen to, and I'm listening to the one called Adoration. I'm going to turn it down just a little bit. I don't know if you can hear me over the music. Yes. Hi, Eddie. Hi, Eddie. Yes, I listen to many of your... many of your scopes. I was talking earlier about my testimony, and it is very important that we tell our testimony. It's very important. And I was telling how I was... I was saved. I had my helmet on, helmet of salvation. But yet I was running around naked otherwise. How old am I? a lot of people think I'm like 20 years younger than I am. I'm in my 50s. So I was saved, but I was running around with just a helmet on, no armor, you know, and living like the devil. Yes, we need to share our testimony, and that's what I'm doing today. I'm sharing my testimony because earlier when I started talking about my testimony, actually I got 45 people listening and they stayed to hear my testimony. I even had a doctor that verified what I said was... you're not interrupting my scope. We're here just to relax and to enjoy the presence of God. But anyway, so I had this big SUV, and I was having trouble with a back tire, and it was making squealing noise, and I was afraid to put it in four-wheel drive. So I live up on a steep hill, and... I mean, I live on the top, and I was going down the steep hill to go into Hammondsport and Bath area. And if anybody knows that area, they know that hill is very steep. And my back tire froze up, and then I spun around the tire and then started flipping down the hill. I managed to miss everything, but as I was going slow, so my seatbelt did not engage, I slipped out of my seatbelt, and this hoodie that I had, you know, kind of like this kind of hoodie, Jesus did it. That's for Rick. That's for Rick Costa. That's his little Periscope group. Anyway, so I was tumbling down this road, and this big angel literally reached out and said, "Israel, come here." That's where I come about calling myself Israel. I don't call myself that easily. In fact, Yeshua did it. Amen. Amen. In fact, I don't call myself that easily. That was just this year that I started calling myself Israel as I was prophesied. But anyway, so I was taken out of my vehicle, literally into a different dimension. And it was a room that was very light. It was like pure light. And I mean, this angel was incredibly large. In fact, I think his ring would have fit around my upper arm. It was such a big ring, because I remember him, like, and that ring was right in my face. So I was in this other dimension, and then as the truck stopped tumbling, I was put back in there. And I was dazed a little bit. I did have a head injury, but otherwise I only had like a scratch. And I know that was a miracle. I know that God sent that angel to protect me. I know it was one of my guardian angels. I don't know if I have more guardian angels, but the life that I've led, I probably have had lots of guardian angels. But I, you know, like I said, I was running around with just my helmet of salvation. I did not have my armor. I was drinking. I had a semblance of God, you know, a semblance of a feeling of God, but I didn't know, you know, how to live a godly life. I wasn't in a good church. So I, hallelujah, so hearts of glory, amen, hallelujah. So I was, like a lot of times when we're delivered from something, I was delivered from alcohol at that point when that angel took me out of my body and took me to wherever they took me. Maybe it was a part of heaven, I don't know. But as I, you know, although I was delivered, I didn't know how to avoid sin. I didn't know what to do. I didn't have a good church. I didn't have Christian friends. I only had drinking buddies. So I fell back into that. This accident happened December 27th. So, New Year's is always a big drinking night, and so I decided I'd go out to the bar. Excuse me. And so I went to the bar, got a beer, and I was only to drink, you know, a little bit, and then I got a horrible headache. And I believe that was God telling me, no. And I know other friends that have, yes, hallelujah. I know that other friends of mine who have been delivered from alcohol, that they will go out and try to get drunk, but alcohol won't do anything for them. So God puts a protection around us. So I wasn't able, this was in 2010. I was not able to drink. I have, I you know, yesterday my family got together. They were having wine and they gave me just a little, touch of wine, and I drank that, and it was the vilest thing. And I know that's God. I know God was protecting me, but I was so bad drinking that my liver was bad. I had health problems, the whole nine yards. And after it was probably March of that next year, so it was probably 3 or 4 months later. I'm not a fake Jew. Sorry that you feel that way. I'm not Jew at all. And I don't proclaim to be Jewish. But that 3 months later, I had a little rear-end accident. And I'm like saying, God, why? God, why? You question God. I know some people think that's a sin, but God knows. God knows your heart. God knows that we need to question things. And so because of that little accident, my son insisted that I go to the emergency room. And that was a good thing because I actually had three broken ribs, but I was not in that much pain. So I sat in the ER waiting room for 8 hours before I was seen. But they put me through all the bells and whistles, and I don't know what open means. I really don't know what open means. You keep telling me that. But they did a CT scan, and I'm like, God, why am I going through all this? Why didn't you protect me? But God was building my faith at that point, because I had lab work. I had a CAT scan, and of course, I had to get those records to bring back to my doctor. And being an X-ray tech, I got to look at the results and look at the scans. And my liver was totally normal. Austin, I will pray for you. My liver was totally normal. Austin, hallelujah. Lord, Austin, I just want to say that God knows. You can be angry with God. You can be angry, but God cannot sin. God is perfect. God has attributes that are way above us. He has plans way above our plans. Somewhere here I have my prayer. Yes, okay. Anyway, Lord, I just ask that you bring ease, that you bring ease to this gentleman that is so mad at you, Lord. Lord, open his eyes and heal his heart and his mind. Renew him so that he sees that he does not have to be mad at you, that it is not you that has let sin into this world, that it is evil. It's our free will. Sometimes, Lord, our choices lead us into hard times, and then we blame you. But it's our free will. It's the evil that entered the world back in the Garden of Adam and Eve. Lord, I just ask that you give peace to this man. Draw him closer to you. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Peace, brother, peace. I know that I often was mad at God. I often, would ask him why. Why? Austin, it's hard. It's a process. You know, the world says that time will heal pain. Time will heal. But that is a lie. That is a total lie. Time does not heal. Time does not heal. Only God can heal. Only God can heal your emotions. Only God can heal your body. I'm just going to play a little bit of music, and if anybody needs prayer, welcome, prophetess. Welcome. Hallelujah. We're talking about testimonies today. We're talking about how it is so important to tell our testimonies. I, years ago, was prophesied over that I had the anointing of miracles on me. And I never knew what that meant. I never knew what that meant. And when I look back on my life, I see that God has had his hands. He's had his hands on me my entire life. And there have been miracles, miracles that I can't explain. No one can explain because they're of God. We can't understand God. We cannot understand him because his thoughts are way above our thoughts. And we just need to trust that what we are going through, and we will get through it. We will get through it. What we are going through, God will bring us through to the other side. And there's times when we don't understand what we're going through. But God gives us free will. God gives us all free will. So sometimes bad things happen to good people because of someone's free will. But we need to forgive them. We have to forgive them. I know it's hard. I know it's hard. Welcome, Rodeo. Welcome. I'm Israel Wendy, and this is the Royal Scope. Good morning. Good morning. Yes, I should be in church. I had my family get together for Thanksgiving, and it didn't go. I mean, it went good except for the relationship between me and my brother. I love my brother.
His love is better than life, and that's reason to praise him always.
I love my brother, but he's not saved. He's homosexual. And we just don't seem to have anything in common. And it's sad because we were so close. We were so close as kids. And so I pray every day for the salvation of those people in my family that are not saved. My brother, my sons. It's really hard. It's a struggle. I mean, in the middle of the night, sometimes I'll wake up in the middle of the night and just start praying for salvation for, you know, my family. There was one morning when I woke up and I had a vision of these Christians being beheaded. And I started praying. I mean, I started praying for those in ISIS that their eyes would be opened. Because it's heavy on my heart. Welcome, welcome. Hi, I'm Israel Wendy. Glad that you could come. We're talking about testimonies. If you have any prayer requests, you can bring them. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I just want you to know that yes, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. God can deliver. God can deliver those from homosexuality, but we need to love them. We can't say mean things to them. We can't condemn them because of their sin. Because a lot of them don't know that what they're doing is wrong. If they're not Christians, they don't know the Christian life. They don't know about the Bible. There are so many people here in America that have never heard of Jesus. And it's funny because they had, not far from me, they had a youth group forming. And they didn't say that it was Christian, nothing. They just, you know, they advertised carnival kind of things. And yes, yes, I will keep you uplifted. Hallelujah. Yes, there's no difference in sin, none at all. But these little kids, They didn't even have never heard about Jesus, and here they were coming, like hundreds and hundreds of kids, just to play these games and stuff. So it was a huge success that all these kids were getting together and they were getting to hear about Jesus for the first time. And probably those kids were going back and talking to their family. I wish there wasn't a glare on my glasses. I would be wearing contacts, but my prescription ran out and I can't afford to get a new prescription and new glasses. But anyway, so it's important for us to tell our testimony. There are those people out there that don't believe that God does miracles to this day. When I was coming home from, I counsel a group of women that have been abused, because I myself went through it. And often our testimony is our ministry. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I love angel visits. I had a friend pray to send me angels, and I said, yeah. Well, I was sitting at work, and suddenly I kept feeling something, and sure enough, there was a bunch of angels around me, and I told him, I says, why did you do that? He says, oh, I just wanted to make you happy. So, you know, God can be whimsical. God can send you little things to make you happy, and he has a sense of humor. I mean, look at the platypus. You know, look at me. God has a real sense of humor. That's another testimony that I have. I told you that somebody told me I had the prophet told me that I had the anointing of miracles on me. And hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, look at chocolate hearts. I love chocolate. But anyway, when I was younger, I had a terrible stuttering problem, and I was legally deaf. I still had hearing, but I was legally deaf. I was tone deaf. I, you know, had that. And, you know, I went through all these different therapies of, you know, like voice lessons so that it could relax my stuttering, so I didn't stutter as much. But I got saved in 97 out in Loveland, Colorado. And I went to a church called The River. It was a huge church. There was quite a few members, upwards to 1,000, I think. And I, that year, I went to a festival called Kingdom Bound. And there was a lot of, there was a lot of ministers, there was a lot of Christian vendors, there was a lot of Christian bands all at this one place. And I went, and my favorite worship leader at the time was Darlene Jack. And so I went, and I had to be up front, of course, because I had that hearing disability. So I was like right in front of the speakers, and I was, you know, having a good time. And after her concert was done, I went to the Newsboys concert. And of course, like I said before, I was up front, I was near the speakers, and I was having a good time, worshiping with my hands up. And suddenly, somebody had my right hand in their hand, and all of a sudden it was so loud, it was so incredibly loud that I like jerked and I looked, and it was Darlene Jack that had my hand in her hand. And I go, wow. And I went to the back of, you know, the auditorium, because it was so loud. So God healed me almost immediately, you know, like it was incredible. And I didn't stutter. I had actually been in singing bands and stuff before that, but I had to have a special monitor. I had to have a monitor that was like very close to me so I could hear myself, so I wouldn't sing off key, the whole nine yards. But all of that was I was delivered from. I had my hearing. It was incredible. And I dedicated my voice and my speech, you know, to God. I didn't always, there was, you know, about 10 years that I kind of went off the, you know, I always had the belief, but I wasn't quite living like I should. And that's when that car accident happened. And because that angel called me Israel, I was like, what does that mean? I didn't even know what that would mean. So I started looking in the Bible. In the first meaning that I found, and I know this was the Holy Spirit, the first meaning of Israel I found in the Bible was the rebellious one. And yes, I was saved, but I was a rebellious one. I was the prodigal son coming back to God. And because of that accident, because of that encounter, that spiritual encounter, I got a desire for the Word. And I know a lot of people do that. I know a lot of people, you know. And I'm trying to think. There was someone else in the Bible that had a spiritual encounter, and because of that, they got a desire for more knowledge. But I just want to say that I just watched a scope. Becky Sims, she has scopes. She did one on forgiveness, and I think that is one of the best scopes that I have ever seen on here about forgiveness. I mean, it is incredible. Yes, hallelujah. I love when that happens. You got so filled. Hallelujah. Tell me more. Yes, I love to hear people's testimony. Becky has such a testimony. She is such a sweetie. I love her. Her and her pink. And if you want to quickly find one of Becky's, if you want to find Becky's scope, you can look under this. Jesus did it. And yes, I actually had... I don't know how to describe this. It's, you know, I know it's 100% God. It's not something that I did, but I helped a young man, and of course there was a language barrier. Yes, write a book. Hallelujah. I'll be the first one to buy it. Hallelujah. There was a young man who lives in Sweden, and his name is, well, his spiritual name is Stephen and Carlo. He goes by Stephen Carlo on Facebook. I also go by Israel Wendy on Facebook. But Stephen Carlo, he had a lot of demons. Most of them were sexual in nature, like incubus and succubus. And through us praying together, he was finally delivered. It took maybe 2 months. It took 2 months. He was a little reluctant at first. He was reluctant because he, you know, he was listening to what the demons were telling him. And he was believing what the demons were telling him. And it took a lot of building him up. It took a lot of encouragement. And finally, he, you know, was released of these demons. And that was the beginning. That was February of this year. And now he has had such a incredible growth in his Christian life. And now he is doing a deliverance ministry where he is helping others to be delivered. Yes, replace the good with the bad. He is doing a deliverance ministry. So if you have access to Facebook, his Facebook name is Stephen Carlo or Carlo Stephen. I'm not sure which one. It may be both. But he has a deliverance ministry. And there is, yes, hallelujah. Like I said, usually those things that you overcome are your ministry. And, I mean, I've overcome alcohol. Yes, Stephen Carlo, yes. And I call him my brother because I prayed for a long time because my brother basically won't have too much to do with me. So I prayed. I says, I want a brother. And it was funny that his spiritual name is Stephen. And my brother's, my natural brother's name is Stephen as well. Yes, he's a great man of God. Yes, he is. There are many great men of God on here. Eddie, oh my gosh, you got to listen to Eddie. If anybody here is not following Eddie Koch, you have to follow his broadcasts. Hallelujah, yes. Miracle Finances, student loaning. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, I just pray today. I just pray today that you will release these debts that are weighing heavy on us, Lord. These student debts, Lord. And I'm not sure what this, if it's a sister or a brother, Lord, but you know the person. Yes, hallelujah. Lord, you say in your word that your blood has covered our debts, Lord. That your sacrifice has covered our debts, Lord. So we ask that you bring that debt cancellation. Bring it, Lord. Bring it to us. Open those floodgates of heaven. Lord, I know that they marched around Jericho for 7 days until those walls came tumbling down, Lord. So, Lord, we fervently pray. We fervently ask that you bring about this debt cancellation and that you prosper us in our finances. All of us, Lord, we all need debt cancellation. We all need financial help in our ministries, in our personal life, Lord. Yes, hallelujah, Jesus. Yes, hallelujah, Jesus. Yes, hallelujah. Thank you, Yeshua, Yeshua, Yeshua. We praise you. We praise you, Lord. We know that our debts are canceled. We know this, Yeshua. Yes, hallelujah, hallelujah. Yes, Lord, yes. Our debts are canceled because of your sacrifice. There is none like you. There is none that could have been that pure sacrifice other than you, Lord. Lord, we ask that these floodgates of heaven be opened and the coffers, the treasure room doors be flung wide and these treasures come pouring down into our lives, Lord, like a waterfall. Lord, I also ask for a fresh anointing, a fresh anointing. We need your encouragement, Lord. We need people standing by us to hold us up, not tear us down. No, Lord, do not let that happen, Lord. Yes, comfort us. Comfort us, Lord, while we're waiting for those finances, those blessings, those miracles of finances, while we're waiting, Lord. Give us comfort. Give us joy. Give us peace. Lord, you have said in your word that faith is an anointing, Lord. So I'm asking for a fresh anointing of faith, Lord. Give us that faith that we know that those finances are coming, that we know beyond a shadow of a doubt. Renew our minds, Lord. Renew our minds and renew our hearts so that we trust you more than and more, Lord. Because you will never leave us or forsake us. You will never leave us, Lord. Hallelujah. So we praise you today. We praise you, Lord. We praise you. Yes, hallelujah. It's all about you, Lord. It's all about you. For the things I've made it, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. To the heart of worship, And it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I've made. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. Yes, it's all about you, Lord. It's all about you, Lord. Yes, wash us in the blood. Lord, help us. Help us to repent. Repenting is not easy, Lord. It is not easy to flee from sin. We become so used to living in that kind of lifestyle. Help us, Lord. Help us to repent. Cover us in our blood, in your blood. Cover us in your protection, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
God, pure and righteous. There is no one like you.
There's no one like you, Lord. Yes, hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah, Jesus. God doesn't make junk. Hallelujah. Lord, I pray for a renewal, a fresh desire for your word. A fresh desire for your presence. Lord, let it flow. Let it flow down. Open those floodgates of heaven. Give us the fresh oil, a fresh renewal, a fresh touch of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Lord, let us wear the mantle of the Holy Spirit upon us. Not just in us, Lord, but on us, so others can see. Others can see that light through us. And they will be drawn to the light like a moth is drawn to the flame. Yes, hallelujah. Lord, we need to get the word out. We need others to come to see, to come to know you, to come to see the truth. And come to have a desire more and more. Yes, we need a fresh touch of the Holy Spirit. Angelic visitations. Lord, I pray for angelic visitations, Lord. Send your minister angels to minister to us in our sleep, in our dreams. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So that we will know you. We will know you more and more. Yes. Woo us like a lover. Woo us like a lover. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. I'm sorry that you do not see the truth. Hallelujah, Jesus. I am sorry that there are those that do not see the truth. They are blinded. Their hearts are hardened. Their hearts are hardened so that they can only see evil, that they are being used as a vessel for dishonor instead of a vessel of honor. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord, I pray that you open their eyes, that they see the love. The love, Lord, the true love, not a fake humanly love, but the true love of God. Touch them, Lord, touch them. Lord, I don't care what their situations are. I don't care what their lifestyle is, Lord. Love them. Let us love them. Hallelujah, Jesus. Yes, love them, Lord, because the world doesn't know love. The world doesn't know peace. The world doesn't know this true love that only God can provide through Jesus Christ. Yes. Draw us close. I'm not even picking these songs, and they're Holy Spirit inspired ones. I'm sorry. Yes. Hallelujah. Let all you friend draw me my desire. Oh Jesus, bring the light. Bring the light in the darkness of this world. Nothing else can take your place. Hallelujah. Yes, hallelujah. Soften the hearts of those who do not know you. Soften the hearts of those who do not know you. Hallelujah. Jesus, hallelujah. I have a little bird sitting on my windowsill looking in. Yes, hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus. I used to think that it was awful to cry, but now I know that it is. It's the Holy Spirit. And I know many people won't agree with me, but I don't want not a single one to perish. And there's so many out there. There are so many people out there that are distracted. They're blinded by hate, blinded by violence. They need Jesus. They need Yeshua. They need Him more than ever. And it's sad because there's Christians out there that won't even talk to a homeless man. They won't even give him a hug because they're afraid, because he's dirty. Yes, hallelujah. There are so many lukewarm Christians up, and there's ministry. You walk out the door of your house, and there is your mission field. Your mission field is right outside that door. There's people out there, and especially in America, in the United States of America, there are people that have never heard of Jesus, and it's because they don't go to church. They're just not taught. They're broken families. There's broken people. And they need love. They don't need criticism. They don't need condemnation. They don't need this finger pointed in their face saying, "Repent, repent, for the end is near." They don't need that. That actually is for us Christians. Repent. Repent, for the end is near. Repent, the end is near. That is for us Christians that know better. Those that have the Holy Spirit speaking to them saying, you know what? You better not do that. That's a sin. And when we are saved, we all get that. We all have that voice of the Holy Spirit. But there's many that have ignored it so long. There are so many Christians that have ignored the voice of the Holy Spirit for so long that they don't even know how to listen any longer. Their ears are closed. God speaks all the time. God is like a radio station that plays 24/7. God is a radio station. He is constantly putting out input into the world, into the spiritual realm. But many of us are not tuned in. Many of us have our radios turned off. And so we're not listening to God. We're doing our own thing. We're way too distracted. Yes, I'm myself get distracted myself. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Feel free to share with your followers. If you're on an Android phone, swipe up. Actually, newer Periscope, because I downloaded the newer Periscope. Yes, hallelujah, hallelujah. Wow, that is such an awesome testimony. Wow, your entire office, that is so... Oh, I wish I could do that. But my, where I work, there's like 700 people. But, oh, wow. Sorry, when I have WhatsApp on my phone, and when I get messages, it makes this freeze up a little bit. So I apologize for that. I haven't figured out how to turn the sound off of that and not off of this. There's got to be a way that I can have like a equalizer or whatever and turn sound off to certain things and not other things. But anyway, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I like this radio station on my computer. I don't have TV. I have not had TV since my kids were little. And my kids are in their 30s now. So the minute that South Park came out and my kids were interested in watching that, I disconnected the cable because I found that they were getting up in the middle of the night and watching these terrible TV programs. Yes, thank you, response. Thank you for coming on. Hallelujah. Bless you. I'll continue to pray for. Yes, hallelujah. I'm just going to let the music run a little bit. And if anybody needs prayer, good morning, good morning. If you need prayer, I'm just going to turn up the worship
classic
music.
Classic praise music from Integrity, Maranatha, Vineyard, and more. It happens Sunday evenings as part of family life.
Bless you. Hallelujah. Now is the time to worship. Yes, we need to worship. Welcome, welcome. Thank you for all your hearts. Now is the time to give. Hallelujah. Yes, hallelujah. Yes, hallelujah. Eddie Cope. You're the prophet. You're a prophet, Eddie. I know you are. Hallelujah. 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 Lord, I just pray for Eddie right now. Lord, he feels alone in his job. He feels alone because a lot of times he doesn't have anything in common with those of the world. Lord, he feels alone. Now, that's not a sin. You felt loneliness too, Lord. But Lord, I'm asking that you repair those bridges at his work where he's in the world are just irritated because we are happy. They don't like us to be happy. They don't like us to be content. They don't like us to be at peace. And Lord, when we are at peace, that irritates them. And it's not them. It's the evil that is in them, Lord. And so I'm asking that you repair this bridge, this, Lord, the slander that is going on at his workplace, Lord, against him. Lord, that you vindicate this man. That you show those that are not of God, that you show those that are lost, that there's something in Eddie, that there is a love in Eddie, there is a light in Eddie. Open those doors, Lord. Open the door so that they will come to him and they will ask him, gee, what do you have? Why are you so happy? They'll come to him, Lord, and they will come to know you, Lord, more and more through him. In the name of Jesus, hallelujah, hallelujah. And Lord, I also ask that you bring favor to Eddie, that you bring favor at his workplace, that those that are in hallelujah, that those that have that those who have come against him in the past will change their view of him, Lord, because they will not see Eddie, they will see you, Lord. They will see what a man of honor he is, a man with virtue, a man with values above that of the world, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. And Lord, I ask that Eddie, that you give him a fresh touch, that you impart on him a fresh oil, an oil that pours into him, Lord, and will ignite the flame that is there. Give him that igniting of that fire that is in him, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Lord, and that fire will glow for miles so that those at his workplace, even if he needs to get a new job, Lord, even, Lord, if it's a new job that you would like him to have, open that door, and Lord, close the door to the dead-end jobs, the dead-end things that don't want him to be involved with, things that will bring trouble, things that will bring unrest. Lord, close those doors. And Lord, you have said in your word that the doors that you open stay open, and the doors that you close stay closed. Hallelujah, Lord. Don't let him be tempted. Don't let him, Lord, be tempted by those things that you do not want for him. Let him to have that path perfectly lit and that door open, Lord. Draw him, Lord, and draw him into you so that he has nude fire to study the word, And a renewed understanding and discernment of the word. Lord, because it is so hard. It is so hard without the Holy Spirit to understand the word of God. It is so hard to do anything, Lord. So I ask for more and more and more of you in Eddie's life. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Lord. And let him praise you. Let him be so filled with joy that he can't help but praise you. In the name of Jesus, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Eddie, you're not unemployed. You're not unemployed. You are working for the Holy Spirit, brother. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Yes, hallelujah, hallelujah. Yes. Yes, this has been quite the year for me, actually. I started out the first time I had ever been in a chat room in January, and I started out in a chat room. It was a prayer chat room on WhatsApp, and I still do ministry on WhatsApp. It's mainly out of Kenya, out of Africa, out of those, you know, countries in Africa. And it started out, I was a little afraid because I had never been in a chat room. I had my identity stolen in the past, so I was afraid to even open my mouth. So I just kind of watched and listened. And there came a lady that was asking for prayer, and no one was praying for her. I thought it was strange. It was like an opening in the chat prayer line where nobody was answering her prayer. So I started praying for her. And I don't even remember the prayer. I do have it written down somewhere because I did have a prayer log. But her prayer was answered. And shortly after that, another lady came to me privately outside of the chat room, just private behind the scenes. And she says, I don't know how to ask for prayer for this, but my sheep are dying because there has not been rain in 3 years. And she lived, and she says, you know, every day I cry because more and more of my sheep die. And so I prayed for her sheep, and then I prayed for rain. And her, I could see her text going on, but then I could watch what was going on in the main chat room. And there were several other people there from New Zealand. And she started saying, and I didn't believe her. You know, she says, it's raining, it's raining. She says, it's a miracle. And it was funny because there were several other people, there was several other people in the chat room that were reporting the same report. It's raining. It hasn't rained in 3 years. It's raining. It's raining. It's a miracle. And I'm thinking, oh my gosh, what did I do? What did God do? I said, God, what are you doing to me? I was like, you know, I was almost afraid of the power. I was afraid of the power of God. I'd never experienced anything like that. You know, it was just incredible. I actually, this is sad to say, but God listened to my prayers. I didn't know how to pray. I just prayed from my heart. And it was shortly after that, the creator of this prayer room I mean, it was minutes later. The creator of this prayer room says, "I'm making you administrator." He says, I'm like, I've never been in a chat room before. He says, this is incredible. And this went on, you know, different miracles and answered prayers went on for a couple of months. And it was a time when God was building my faith in. And then so later on, you know, it slowed down, the answered prayer slowed down. And I don't understand that. But I guess God wants us to stand. Not only is he raising our faith by answering our prayers, we have to continue to pray, and we have to have faith even when our prayers are not answered, or we don't think that our prayers are answered. I mean, a lot of people, you pray for them and their prayers are answered, and they don't tell you, you know, they don't, well, I was healed, you know, I don't know why, but people feel that. I don't understand why people wouldn't tell that they were, you know, healed. I had to get a little bit of my dollar, McDonald's dollar coffee. Yes, hallelujah, hallelujah. The cell phone bill is paid in the name of Jesus, hallelujah. I got to tell you, that's another thing. Just one day out of the blue, I got this notice that my garbage bill was paid. And somebody that they wanted to remain anonymous, but they were from Indiana. They paid my garbage bill, and I'm like, you know, who even knows that I had a garbage bill? I never mentioned it to anyone that I had an outstanding garbage bill, you know, let alone somebody in Indiana. They just out of the blue sent the money and they paid off my garbage bill. I don't know if it's somebody that worked for the company. I have no clue. And I'm like, I'm praying, God, what is this? What is this all about? And I heard the Holy Spirit say, I'm taking out the garbage. And the Holy Spirit was talking about taking out of the garbage from me. And so this year has been a process of healing, a process of taking the garbage out of my life. You know, there have been friends that have been taken out of my life. And of course I was dearly hurt, especially when a dear friend of mine, I let her, move into my house, because she said that her husband was beating on her. And so I offered her a place to stay because I have a 3-bedroom house and I'm the only one living here. So I have quite a lot of room. I have an acre of land. It's very private, it's kind of hidden so that, you know, she could hide from her husband. And she was a professed born-again Christian, but I guess that doesn't guarantee that things will be... So the minute she moved into my house, of course, she wanted to be put on the deed to my house. I wanted to take over my life. I was suddenly the child and she was the adult. And she, every day when she left for work, she would leave me Bible assignments. As, you know, and I just could not. And I'm praying to God. I said, God, I don't know what to do. Help me to get her out of the house. Because this is not working. She is trying to take charge of my life. She's taking over my life. And one day she decided, she was going to the church with me, the same church. And one day she says, oh, I don't feel good. I'm not going to go to church. She had already planned that she was going to leave. So she was packing up her car and she hadn't quite finished when I got home because I got home early. And she was dragging out a garbage bag to pack into her car. And it was filled with half of my stuff. You know, who does that? And then the bag accident, you know, I wouldn't have thought anything of it. But the bag ripped open and you know, my stuff came falling out of the bag. And she goes, oh, I don't know how that got in there. And I'm thinking to myself, well, you packed the bag. You packed the bag, you know. Not only did she, you know, use the garbage bag, she took all of my garbage bags. And so it's been hard for me to forgive her, but I started praying for her. She actually started her own church, which is kind of horrifying to me. She actually believes that Satan and all of the demons are locked up in hell right now, and they don't affect us. Wow. That would be nice. That really would be nice if Satan was already locked up in hell. Yes, the cell phone is I decree and declare in Jesus' name, in Yeshua's name, that cell phone will be paid by the end of the month in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So she moved out. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Yes, hallelujah. Eddie, I am so glad you've joined this broadcast. I feel honored, actually. I feel very honored. A friend of mine, if Rick Costa gets on here, I just want to tell them that, yes, I'm in my pajamas. But I do have my sweatshirt here that has his logo on it. So, and I also am part of a three apostle group. I laugh about that. It sounds like the three amigos. But there's three of us that support each other. And we do what we call Royal Scopes. And Ahmad Thornton, he is an awesome prophet. Ahmad Thornton. Yes, hallelujah, hallelujah. I do, I love Rick Scopes. He's so professional. I can't be professional. I cannot be professional. I'm too much of a joker. I think God had God has quite, like I said before, he has quite a sense of humor because of me. I'm a big joker. I'm one of those that never want to grow up, and here I'm in my 50s. But so my friend Donna moved out, and I pray for her. You know, forgiveness is hard. It's hard to forgive people. It took me 3 days to initially start to forgive the man that broke into my house and raped me. It took me longer. It took me longer to forgive my best friend of many years. And she slandered me within several churches. In fact, when I started having visions and started telling people about my visions, no, I never got my stuff back, but I don't worry about it. I don't even know, I didn't take inventory, so I don't know what she took, but that, like I said, that happened this summer. I pray for her. And when you pray for those who do bad things to you, you know, like I said, it's a process to forgive somebody. It's been a process. Oh, I hope she's convicted by the Holy Spirit. She, like I said, she's starting her own church, but she has these weird doctrines. And so I have to pray for her every day because she's going to lead so many people astray. You know, she's trying to tell people that Satan and his demons are already locked up and cannot affect us. If that was true, there would be no sin in the world. I mean, that would be awesome. It would be so awesome if Satan was already locked up in heaven, or locked up in hell. But anyway, I pray for her every day. I pray for her ministry, you know, and I pray for her husband to find salvation, because it's just a bad situation. But when you start praying for people, you have like an investment in them. You have an investment, and then you can start to forgive them. You know, it's yes, she's listening to the enemy. But yes, hallelujah. I'm just kind of going over the things that have happened to me this year. If you've joined, you might want to go back and listen to, you know, some of my testimony. But I'm just telling people what happened to me this year. This year has been crazy. It started out with, I was so depressed and so frustrated and alone on the holidays. And I just got down on the floor, bawling my head off, and said, Jesus, just kill me. Just kill me. God, strike me dead. And I believe he did. I believe that he killed all the junk that was in me. I mean, there's still junk in me. There is still junk in me, but God is killing that. The more that you read the word, the more that you worship, the more that you pray, and like I said before, I did not know how to pray, but I just started, and I watched and I listened to what other people were, how they were praying. Welcome. I'm Israel Wendy. Yes, hallelujah. We are all sons and daughters of the King. Hallelujah. But I, you know, you just have to start somewhere. If you just spend like a minute praying, that God dotes on that. God wants every second that he can get. He wants to spend time with you. And you know, I was thinking about tithing the other day. If we tithed our time, if we tithe our time with God, because he wants 10%. And some people may say, well, that's Old Testament. But I'm just saying, I'm not arguing doctrine. But if we tithe our time to God, we should be giving him 2.5 hours a day. I figured it out. I sat down and figured it out. 2.5 hours a day we should be giving God. Yes, is... But, so anyway, after, Donna moved out, she was my best friend for many years. We were, constantly pray. Yes, we should be constantly looking to our God because, you know, in my past, I've made the worst choices that you can imagine. I mean, either through lack of not making a choice or through just terrible choices and letting other people dictate, you know, my life. And so we have to depend solely on God because if we listen to what the world is saying, oh my gosh, you know, the United States, and I may sound a little religious, United States, it's okay to you know, have sex outside of marriage. It's no big deal. Word, you know, that's terrible. It's terrible. It's sin always leads to death. I'm freezing up now. I got a window because my phone is getting very hot. I don't think people have that problem. Do you got Apple phones? And yes, I do have a Samsung Galaxy phone. And it hasn't set on fire yet, but it's one of it's the Galaxy Prime Core. It's not the one that starts on fire. Boy, have I had many jokes about, hi, how are you again? I've had so many jokes about the phones catching fire. Oh my gosh. You know. I was thinking, you know, back in the olden days, they used to call it a three-dog night because, you know, it would be so cold that you had to have three dogs to keep you warm. Well, now it's a three-phone night. Three phones to keep you heated up. Three cell phones. Oh, gosh. Sorry, I'm so silly, but hi, how are you? Hallelujah, hallelujah. Gracias. Hallelujah. I only know un poco, a little bit of Spanish, because I always had an interpreter with me when we, I did worship. I led worship in the Dominican. And if you are thinking about being a missionary and you would like a little training, the name of the group that I went with, and for $1,000, you can go for a week to the Dominican. That includes your food, your lodging, everything, and your airline ticket, and it goes through, the name of the organization is Meeting God in Missions, and it was founded by a man that was a basketball coach in the Olympics back in 1973. And he put all of his money into this mission. So it's quite, yes, Meeting God in Missions. It's an awesome organization. I learned quite a bit about missions. And it's cheap and you're safe. You're housed, you know, on a secure mission building. You have purified water to drink. It's a nice organization. If your family, they have family cottages where you can stay that are, oh my gosh, they are so beautiful. They have like marble fixtures, and it's just incredible. And their mosaics and their tile is incredible. It is a life changing thing to go on a mission. It really is. It opens your eyes. I mean, they were so impoverished. Oh, my buddy is here for breakfast. I wonder if he brought his wife. I have two squirrels that have discovered how to get to the food. Yes, missions, they're life-changing. They really are. I mean, we were in... I know Haiti is worse than the Dominican, but the Dominican was really bad. People lived under... entire families lived under a piece of tin on dirt floors. Entire families. And yet they would have their motorcycle. It's like they're showing me their motorcycle and they're living in. Oh, my squirrel friend is here. I tell you, if push comes to shove, I'm going to eat that squirrel. He's so big. He's fat. And I've been feeding him. He's been eating my suet. I have a bird feeder that is squirrel proof, but I have a suet feeder right on top of it. So he can't get in the bird feeder, but he gets in the suet feeder and sometimes he knocks it down. And I have these little solar lights all along my house. Yes, hallelujah, hallelujah. Yes, and he has knocked those down. But I like watching him. He's entertaining. So again, I implore you to tell your testimony. Get it out there. Find a good Bible-based church. I mean, you know, at least go to a Bible study so that you can meet people that are... the believe the same way, because we really need people to hold us up. I don't know if you know the Bible, but there is a story in the Bible about Moses, and when he was praying, he actually had Aaron and Miriam, two fellow believers, holding his hands up so that he can continue to pray because he was so weak. And we need, number one, we need the fresh oil. We need to be fed by the Holy Word. We need worship. We need to get, hey, Justin, how are you? We need to be refueling. I mean, if we are constantly fighting spiritual battles, we need to recharge our battery. And you guys know what I mean, because even if you're just going about your daily life, you are being attacked. You may not realize it, and some of it, hey, I'm great, I'm doing good. Although I'm being bad today, I'm missing church. Hallelujah. I just got back from having my Thanksgiving from my parents. And so I spent the night on the couch. So I came home and I immediately put my pajamas on. Again, I'm sorry that my parents... Periscope up. It's because I'm in a rural area. So you need Justin, do you need any prayer today? We're getting snow. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We're talking about testimonies today. We're talking about forgiveness. We're listening to some music. Justin, this is off of familylife.org. And there's a radio, streaming radio right on the thing. And I'm under adoration. There's different ones. There's gospel. There's even Christmas music. Family Life. And they play this Christmas music. All year. I think it would drive me crazy. Not that I'm against Christmas, but it is so commercialized, and I don't believe in tree worship, and I haven't put up a Christmas tree in probably 12 years. But, radio station. I don't think I like it. How about gospel? Oh, this is the news. All right. I'll go back to the adoration. I like that one. Oh, there's more. I could have... There's two Christmases. I bet they don't have Grandma Got Run Over by a Reindeer. Oh, look at that. I had like a green... white out on my screen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You know, to tell you the truth, I have been trying to get together a worship band. A worship band. I've been trying to get them together, but nobody wants to do just worship music. They want to do, you know, contemporary stuff that I want music that will solely worship God. And I have been told by more and more, you know, Christian artists that, oh, nobody will listen to that. And it's sad. It's really sad. It is really sad. Back in the 80s, I was in a rock band. But I, you know, to get a Christian band together that is solely, and I do know some that just do worship, and they don't charge. They go, you know, from church to church. Okay, I'm listening. Should I write this down? Yes, I'll write it down. God is love. Okay, I am paying attention. I think I'm kind of squirrely, like that squirrel. I'm writing it down. This is Eddie. In Stanford, Connecticut. So you are about 8 hours from me.